Howdy folks, welcome back to World of Tanks with the Mighty Jingles, and what do you think of that new intro? I like it. Obviously I like it, I wouldn't have put it at the front of the video. not that I had anything against the old intro, but I just like changing things up every now and then. And new intro, very graciously designed by Micah Designs. Link to his YouTube channel in the video description. Does some great stuff and very generously offered a new intro for the World of Tanks videos, and there it is. So thanks very much for that. I hope you like it. If you don't like it, tough, because it's what I'm going to be using from now on, at least until I get bored, many months down the line, and change the intro around again. So anyway, tanks, yes, still on the patch 8.9 test server, still looking at the German tank destroyers, the new line of German tank destroyers, starting with the Marder 2, which we looked at in the previous video, and it's been rebalanced in patch 8.9, but it's no better and no worse than it was before, which is bad news because it's just as crap as it was before, unfortunately. But the good news was you would only have to stick this thing out for 3,800 XP in order to unlock the Marder 38T or the Marder 3 here at tier 4, and this thing is great. I absolutely loved this little thing. It's basically the way the Marder 2 was at tier 3 before he got beaten to death with the Nerf bat. This thing plays at tier 4 exactly the same way, and it's just as good. So I can see people having a lot of fun with this thing. But all good things must come to an end, and after you've ground out the XP on this thing that you need for the tier 5, you get this. The Flak Bus. Look at that. It's, yeah, it's an anti-aircraft gun. On a bus. It's the Flak Bus. I'm not even going to attempt to pronounce the actual German name. I'm just bad. So from now on, the Flak Bus is what it is. And I like the name Flak Bus. It kind of suits it. It's the kind of machine, you know, it's like the TOG. It just looks ridiculous, but it's got so much character. It's like a really, really ugly dog that you just can't help loving anyway because it's got so much character and personality. And, you know, that's what this thing's like. But it is a really, really good machine as well. But it's not without its drawbacks. We'll take a look at the stats and I'll show you the sort of thing I'm talking about. It only has 350 hit points. So it's basically going to get one shot killed by anything Russian that so much as looks in its general direction. But hey, no difference there between that and the Stug, which also only has 350 hit points, also at tier 5. It's very, very light. It's a 26-ton machine, and it has a 400-horsepower engine. So, phenomenally good power-to-weight ratio. And it has a top speed of 60 kilometers per hour. And a traverse speed of 48 degrees per second. That is light scout tank levels of speed and maneuverability in a tank destroyer the size of the Ferdinand. Yeah, do not adjust your sets. Your eyes are not deceiving you. This thing is as big as the 30. One thing it doesn't have, however, is the Ferdinand's armour. This thing is 20 millimeters of armour at the front. That's right, that's a 2 and a 0. That's all. And 14 millimeters at the side and rear. Oh dear. It kind of reminds, even though it looks nothing like it, it kind of reminds me of a certain other tier 5 tank destroyer, the T-49, and to a lesser degree the Hellcat at tier 6. And you will often see in your tier 5 and 6 games some imbecile in a T-49 or a Hellcat being the first one to die, because, you know, just because you can do 60 or 72 kilometers per hour doesn't mean you have to. And that's a lesson that you're really going to need to take to heart with the Flak Bus as well, because yes, it is blisteringly fast. Yes, it is very, very manoeuvrable, but it only has 350 hit points, and it only has 20 millimeters of armor. If you drive this thing the way people drive T-49s, and the way a lot of people drive Hellcats, you'll just be the first one killed, the same way a lot of T-49 and Hellcat drivers end up being the first one killed. The speed and maneuverability of this thing is going to get this thing killed in its thousands. Don't be one of those players, right? Think about what you're doing when you're driving this thing. This thing does have massive, massive advantages, and they're basically all around the gun. But it cannot go up close and personal with enemy tanks. This is probably the purest sniping machine in the game that there has ever been. That is what it exists to do. And I'll show you what I mean when we get onto the gun. But first, and also to do with why this thing is a dedicated 100% sniping killer tank destroyer, it's because of the view range. 380 meters. That's like tier 9, 10 vehicle view range. This is tier 5. Even the American open-topped tank destroyers don't have that good a view range at this sort of level. The T-49, for example. Where is it? There it is. Well, let's have a look at it with a second turret. And this was always the strong suit of the American open-turreted tank destroyers. Their phenomenal view range. And 350-meter view range is good for Tier 5, but it's not as good as 380. Even the Hellcat. 370-meter view range. And the view range of the Hellcat was fantastic for a Tier 6 machine. Still not as good as the German Tier 5 flak bus. That view range and these guns are the reasons why you need to keep this thing back, in combination with, you know, the crappy armour and the fact that this thing is the size of a Ferdinand. This thing's going to be really hard to hide. You're going to need to be in concealment, letting other vehicles do the spotting for you, and then you kill them with the selection of fantastic guns this thing has. Speaking of the guns, it gets a choice of three. And I believe this might be one of those machines where all three guns are good, but I think the stock gun, the 75mm Flak L60, is better than the second gun, the 88mm Flak 37 L56. Although the top gun, the 88mm L74, is unquestionably the best of the three. And yeah, that's right, do not adjust your sets. That is a choice of two 88mm guns on a Tier 5 tank destroyer. This thing is all about the guns. Don't be using that speed manoeuvrability. Just throw your life away at the start of the game, the way you see so many T-49 and Hellcat drivers do. Right? Don't be that stupid. Put this gun to work. So let's have a look at the guns, and I'll show you the sort of thing I'm talking about. It's got a choice of three. And all three guns are... what's the right word? Well, you can only get these guns on this machine. None of the other tank destroyers in the German lines use any of these guns. You go up to tier 6 with the Nashorn. Oh, I did it wrong again. Oh, I'm going to catch out for that in the comments. You go up to tier 6 with the Nashorn. Sorry, Germans. And it uses completely different weapons. So, where is it? There we go. 75mm Flak L60. This is not a terrible gun at all. Remember, this thing is only tier 5. 15 rounds per minute, 139 penetration, 135 damage, 0.35 accuracy, 1.7 second aiming time. Now, it's not as good as the L70 75mm gun on the Stug, but it shouldn't be. The L70 is the top weapon available on the Stug. This is the stock weapon on the Flak bus. So I wouldn't expect it to be as good as the L70 on the Stug. But it's still pretty damn good. Tier 5 machine with 139mm penetration, 15 rounds per minute, acceptable damage, 135, good accuracy, 0.35, very, very fast aiming time, 1.7. That's not a bad gun. After you've used that, the next gun upgrade is this. It's an 88mm gun. It's the L56. It's the same gun that most of the German Tier 6 medium tanks use. It's the same gun that the Flak Panzer, the Jagdpanzer IV, uses at tier 6, but we're getting it down here at tier 5. And on a tier 5 machine, this actually isn't that bad. I'm always complaining about this gun on the German tier 6s and 7s because it's just not good enough. And for a lot of people driving the Flak Panzer at tier 6 will not use this gun. They'll stick to the Stug's gun, the 75mm, because it just has better penetration, it's better aiming time, and it's more accurate. The only thing you really get with the 88 is better damage, 220 damage. Everything else is inferior. However, it's not bad on a tier 5 machine. You've got, okay, the rate of fire sucks, 8.82. The penetration's, well, 132 is fine for a tier 5. It's when you stick this thing on a tier 6 or 7 that it starts to suck. But a tier 5 132 penetration isn't bad. It's not as good as the 75mm, but it's still not bad. 220 damage, though, much, much better than the 135 with the 75. The accuracy is the same, 0.35. The aiming time is not quite as legendary, but it's still bloody good, 1.9 seconds. So, you know, that's not a bad gun. But I suspect that people are going to be using... my recommendation as well would be to carry on using the 75mm instead of the 88, and it's because of the 1.7 second aiming time. We'll come on to that in a minute when we look at the 88 L74 gun. Speaking of which, here it is. Now, this is the one you want. This is definitely, beyond question, the best gun on the tank, and it's effectively, it's very, very similar to the long 88mm gun that you get on the Tiger, which is two tiers higher and is a heavy tank. It has a 8 rounds per minute rate of fire, so it's only fractionally worse than the 88mm L56. The penetration is phenomenally good for a tier 5 machine, 194mm with 240 average damage. It's even got better damage than the short 88. Better accuracy, 0.32. The only place it suffers is in the aiming time. Now, I mean, 2.3 seconds aiming time isn't bad. It's pretty good, but it's not as good as the two previous guns. Now, this thing does look pretty comical, and the reason I keep going on about the aiming time is because of another factor, which is not given in the stats of the machine, and that's to do with the gun traverse. However, before we go on to that, the reason this thing looks so stupid is because it's not designed to be fought with the sides and the rear up. They are actually designed to hinge and fold down and become platforms for the crew to stand and operate the gun from. In real life, that gun could actually traverse 360 degrees all the way around. You didn't fight this thing with the side panels up. You know, that was just not how it was done, as you can see from the following picture. There you go. That's how the thing actually looked when it was deployed and ready to fight. However, it doesn't work like that here in World of Tanks. And because of that, that means that this gun, you can see there is not a lot of space in here to turn that gun around. And that means this thing has almost French tank destroyer levels of crappy gun traverse. You can only really turn the gun about that much to the left and right. And that's why I kept making mention of the aiming time. Because with a 2.3 second aiming time, if an enemy vehicle is moving laterally across your front, you are probably only going to get one shot at it. With that 8 rounds per minute, a narrow gun traverse, and a 2.3 second aiming time, you're probably only going to get one shot at him before you have to move the machine, aim ahead of him, wait for it to aim, fire again. And every time you move the machine to do that, you've got to wait for your binoculars, you've got to wait for your camo net, you've got to wait for all that sort of good stuff. That is the principal reason why I would say stick to the 75mm, don't bother using the 88mm L56 until you upgrade to this 88 here. Purely because you don't get an awful lot much more for your money with a short 88 than a bit more damage. You trade off penetration, you trade off accuracy, and you trade off aiming time. And the aiming, well, you don't trade off accuracy, they're both the same accuracy. But that 1.7 second versus 1.9 second aiming time just means that if you're using that short, the 75mm, you can get more shots on target before you have to move the thing and aim again. Now, again, because of that 2.9 second aiming, sorry, not 2.9, it's not near as bad as that, that 2.3 second aiming time, it's still pretty good. And the way to maximise, I find, the effectiveness of this vehicle, I mean, there's a number of factors that you need to bear in mind. Yes, it's very fast, but you need to use that speed just to get yourself first to a good ambush position. You do not ever want to be the furthest one forward in this tank, because you'll just die. No armour, it's a massive target, it's impossible to miss, it's hard to hide, and it only has 350 hit points. So use the speed wisely to get to a good ambush position, wait for your friends to move in front of you, and then start shooting at targets that they light up. stay as far back as you can. Not just because you don't want to get shot at. You don't want to get detected. Getting detected in this thing, you just die. But stay as far back as you can, because the further you are away from the targets that you're shooting at, and you don't really need to worry about hitting them with 0.32 accuracy, but the further away from them you are, the less you have to turn the gun to shoot them when they move. And therefore, the less you have to turn the whole tank. So you're not going through that whole 2.3 second aiming time cycle over and over again every time you take a shot at a fast moving target. That would be my recommendation anyway. Now, as far as equipment and crew skills are concerned, crew skills, really simple. Camo, 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 and camo. And as soon as your commander reaches 100%, sixth sense. And then camo again. Right, this thing needs to remain undetected. 350 hit points, 20 millimeters of armor. If this thing gets spotted, it's just gonna die. I mean, you couldn't miss it. Look at it. Nobody misses when they fire at this thing. It seems to be a magnet for shots. The second it gets detected, it just dies. So don't get detected. Camouflage, camouflage, camouflage. As far as equipment fit goes, well, obviously you're going to want a gun rammer, but you're also going to want binocular telescopes. I know they're an expensive purchase, but I think they're going to be worth it, especially if you plan to keep using this thing even after you've unlocked the new Tier 6. Because of that 380 meter view range, with a binocular telescope, an extra 25% bonus to that view range. I know I'm sitting here saying, yes, you need to keep this thing in cover, in concealment, in the second line of the battle, and give supporting fire to the guys who are actually spotting the targets for you. But and in a perfect game, that's exactly what would happen. But how often do we have perfect games? A lot of the time, you're going to find yourself having to spot targets for yourself. If you get detected in return, you just die. So you need as much view range as possible with this thing. Keep them at arm's length, not just to prevent you from being shot at, but also because the further away you can spot them, the easier it is to engage them with the narrow gun traverse and the not slow but slower aiming time on the long 88mm gun than on the other guns. So getting the most out of your view range on this thing is paramount. As for your third equipment slot, it's really up to you. I mean, I fitted this thing with an enhanced gun lane drive to get the aiming time down. But the aiming time is not bad. The aiming time is only an issue because of the narrow gun traverse of the gun. So an enhanced gun lane drive isn't a terrible idea, but equally, you could use a camouflage net. And really, it's just whatever you can afford, and whichever one suits your style of play. Speaking of style of play, let's get some games in. Right, here we go. Test server tier 5 matchmaking at its finest. I was actually lucky to get this game thanks to one of the factors. Normally, if you're trying to play something on the test server that's like tier 3, 4, 5, 6, and to a degree tier 7 as well, these are the kind of matches you end up in, right? There's hardly anybody. This is the best the matchmaker can do. It's a little bit better in this version of the test server, patch 8.9, because of the new Japanese tier 5 premium medium tank, and the new, as you can see there, the Russian T-44-85, the new Tier 7 Russian premium medium tank, because people are trying those things out. There are actually things sitting in the matchmaking queue that I can actually have a game with. By the way, look at how fast this thing is. Look at have you ever seen something so big move so quickly? I'm chasing E-25s. Tell you what, I wish I was the size of an E-25 with this gun. That would be fantastic, but you know, I'm not. Speaking of E-25s, you know, that's not a bad aiming time. Not bad at all. Now, one thing that you can't see in the replay, because they've never worked in replays, is another new thing that's coming in patch 8.9, a built-in reload timer. All those of you, myself included, who use reload timer mods are never going to need to use them anymore, because World of Tanks is coming with one built in. And you can see the rate of fire of this gun is not terrible. Not terrible at all. KV-13. Oh, wait a minute. Tough armor on the hull, so I'll aim at the turret, and it bounces anyway. I sometimes wonder about the choice of tanks that people use. Oh, yeah, yeah, that's got you. He's probably going to die before I get to finish him off. Oh, no, I got him. Oh, hello. There's the new tier 7. And yeah, this is the kind of game, unfortunately. Although, it did certainly, when I saw I was getting into a very, very heavily tier 7 game, it certainly encouraged me to play this thing the way you should play it. Sit back, let other people spot for you, and not take any chances. In some of the other games that we've gotten into, there have been so few people playing that if you try to play it like that, much as I did with the Marder 38T video, that you have to rush forward and get stuck in, otherwise there's nothing left to shoot at. This was not one of those games, fortunately. Yeah, this is pretty much a whitewash. We're winning 6-1. And now I start moving forward, but there's only 4 of them left, there's only 3 of them left, there's only 2 of them left, and neither of them are down this side of the map. So, speed manoeuvrability. Look how quickly you can whip this thing around and then start zooming off in the other direction. I'm hoping to kill the E-25. But there's an unlocated KV-1 out there somewhere as well. Unfortunately, that was it for this game. And not particularly entertaining to watch, I admit. But you can see the speed. You can see the manoeuvrability. You can see the accuracy. And just the raw damage output of this gun. If you keep the thing hidden. If you stay back. If you let other people spot for you. And it was lucky enough, this is one of the very few games that I've played on the test server where I was actually able to do that. So there's that. But I have had a better game than this. And we're going to see that next. Yeah, that's more like it. As luck would have it, you know, this was the very first game that I played in the FLAC bus. And it is the only game in 2 days of playing this machine. This is the only game where we've had a full team on each side, and it hasn't just been me and a whole bunch of tier 7s. So it was quite fortunate that this was a decent game. You know, as I mentioned in the previous clip, if it wasn't for the fact that there were so many people wanting to try out this new Japanese tier 5 medium tank, I would never have been able to get a game like this. Luckily, I did, and here it is. So, bearing in mind my phenomenally good view range, my good speed, but the fact that this is a big target, it has no armour, and you can probably hit it and see it from the other side of the map. I'm not going to be too brave this time around. Oh, wasn't watching where I was going, drove into a tree. Never mind. This isn't actually a bad matchup for that Marder 38 either. Or even the Panzer 1C, because those Japanese mediums are not exactly over-endowed with armour. So even the Panzer... No, he's gotten himself killed already. Okay, never mind. Looks like all the light tanks are just throwing themselves to their deaths. So no real difference from the live server there. T-34. Who goes on to the test server to drive a T-34? Oh well, never mind. Okay, plenty of people up in front. No targets as yet. Plenty of targets, but none that I can see from here. Very surprised, actually, that there are only... Oh, there we go. And... crap, it missed. And I've been spotted. And I'll hang around to take one shot and kill that T-34, and then I'll get the hell out of there. But yes, very surprised that there's only three of the new German tank destroyers in this game. Very, very surprised indeed. You would have expected, certainly when you get up the higher tier matches, and you have no problem with a matchmaker finding games for you in the higher tier games. It's just 2/3 of both teams are tank destroyers. Look at this gun go to work. Critical hit. Well, at least it hits. And speculative fire there didn't get him. So he's still out there somewhere. Oh, actually, no. Somebody, it looks like somebody else hit him. Somebody just killed another Chinookai. Probably that fella down there. We'll soon find out. Let's have a look. Now, the guys in town are... Oh, no, there he is. 2.3 second aiming time. Not bad at all. He's dead. So there's my second kill. Now, at this point... I mean, this is a wrap. We're winning 10-5. But those Churchills are putting up a tough fight. There's usually somebody camping the ridgeline up there, so I'm waiting to take shots. But then again, those Churchills and the Chinookais with them are actually winning the battle for the town. So, 60 kilometres per hour? Yeah, we can do that. This is a big machine, though, so I need to take advantage of whatever terrain features I can. Cruise along the riverbed here. Keep myself out of line of sight. Look at this, we were winning 10-5 a minute ago, and suddenly the outcome of this game is no longer quite so cut and dried. It looks like we killed all the nubs, and the only guys left on the enemy team actually know what they're doing. My apologies if you're watching this video and you're one of the players who's already dead. Anybody can have a bad day. But yeah, those guys left in the town are really kicking ass. We've got a T-49 up there. That's a very brave of a T-49. Getting in there and messing it up with heavies and mediums in that thing. It doesn't seem to be doing him any harm, though. You know, he's not dead yet. I'm going to try to take advantage of whatever he's spotting. Looks like we've been about to nail their artillery. Our road mediums have made their way into the enemy base. I hope they're not going to try to cap. Because we totally got these guys. Oh, great. Our artillery has just team-killed one of our own Chinookais. It's probably going for the enemy artillery. And just didn't care that a friendly was in close combat with him. Alright. Did I mention how amazingly fast this thing is? Okay. One of those Chinookais is trying to cap. So this is actually a good thing, because he's never going to cap in time. And all of these Churchills and that other Chinookai are now going to be facing the other way. Which means I should be able to come up behind them. Yeah. Ah, oh, typical. Oh, hello. Ah, he's seen me. Thank you. I will not get another one. Now, I'm relatively lucky that these are only Mark III Churchills shooting at me. Because they're very, very low damage output. But very, very rapid firing, and I sure just a little too slow. Chinookai on very low health, and a Churchill 3. The Churchill 3, he can kill me. I only have 272 health left. And his gun fires once every 2 and a bit seconds. Of course, he has to have his gun pointing the right way for that to work. Here we go, this is what I'm talking about. He hits me once, he hits me twice, he hits me 3 times, and I kill him. If his gun had been pointing the right way, I'd died. And that's why you absolutely cannot let this thing get shot at, because you just die. It has no armor, it has no health. You need to use this thing as a sniper. It's probably the purest sniping machine in the game. It's a huge target. Nobody's going to miss it. If you get spotted, you're just going to die. So take that lesson to heart. You can see there that in the time it took me to load the second shot, even something with only 75 damage per shot like a Churchill 3 very nearly managed to kill me. But he didn't, and I killed him, and so we won. And that was quite a good start, because that, as I said, was the first game that I ever played in this thing. And apparently that's good enough for a first-class mastery patch. and it was a fun little game. But while I did reasonably well, if my previous video on the Modder 38T hasn't convinced you to get one of these the second patch 8.9 goes out, then have a look at that. Russian player there in the Modder 38T, just making everybody else look bad. He had a monster game. Very, very good little machine. But for myself, 10 shots fired, 8 hits, 7 penetrations. Most of those shots from extremely long range, where this thing really, really shines. But again, and I really need to hammer this point home, look at that potential damage received of 300 with 4 hits, all of them penetrating. There is no potential damage received in this thing. There's just damage received. All right, everything that hits you penetrates and does damage. So don't get hit. That's the only way to make this thing work. So, Germans now have a choice of 2 tank destroyers at Tier 5, the Stug and the new kid on the block, the Flakbus. Why would you take the Stug over this? It's a good question, a question which I'm sure a lot of people are going to be asking. The Stug has still got something that this thing doesn't have, and that's the stealth value. It also has better armour than this thing. Anybody who's been firing a 75 or a 76mm gun at the front of a Stug and getting frustrated as it keeps bouncing off that 80mm of frontal armour will know what I'm talking about. There's still place for the Stug in the game, but I do think that this is a very, very nice alternative. With this thing, it's all about the gun. And the gun selection on this machine is incredibly, incredibly good. You just have to keep it at range and make sure nothing spots you. And if you can do that, you're going to have a lot of fun in this machine. I certainly have. So, that's it for today. The new German Tier 5 tank destroyer, the Flakbus, which I don't care what the real name is, that's what I'm calling it. Hope you found the video amusing, entertaining, or at the very least, educational, and learnt a couple of things, possibly, about the new German Tier 5 tank destroyer. As always, folks, take care on that battlefield, and I will catch you next time.